So, Alexis, what has been one of the most challenging things that you've experienced or are currently experiencing?
The premature birth of my son, Phoenix. He was born 15 weeks premature. That's been a challenge. Thankfully, right now, it hasn't been so much of that uphill battle anymore. There's not so much of the worry and the concern, but for 4 months, it was day by day, minute by minute, breath by breath. Not something you ever expect to happen.
Tell me about going into labor, what sort of play-by-play, what that experience was like for you.
I initially went into labor on Saturday the 29th, and we were in the middle of a huge snowstorm. Called the doctor, and none of my doctors were in, so they sent me up to Charlotte Hungerford Hospital, told me to talk to the on-call doctor there. I'd never met the doctor. Actually, he didn't even make it into the hospital to come see me because the snow was too bad. They told me that I wasn't in labor to go home. I kept insisting, this is my fourth child. I know what contractions are. I know what labor is. Mm-hmm. And I had started bleeding. I said, I'm concerned. There's no reason to be concerned. Just go home. You're dehydrated. Just go home and drink. Put your feet up. Relax. They ran no tests. They did nothing. So Jeffrey drove me home and pumped me full of fluids all night, but the contractions never stopped. Next morning, after I don't know how many glasses of water, I go into the bathroom and felt pressure. Went back to go relax, lay on the couch, had to go back into the bathroom. I thought I had to pee again. Go back in and my water breaks. And I stood in the bathroom for a minute because it didn't register to me what had just happened. And I felt pressure and was bleeding. I was like, okay, there's a problem. Wait a minute, that my water just broke. And went right out. Jeffrey was sleeping in a chair. He was laid back in a chair in an ottoman next to the fireplace asleep. And I went over, and usually he's a bear to wake up. Mm-hmm. I shook his foot. I said, Jeff, my water broke. He was up in a second. Trying to call the doctor to let them know. And couldn't get through. Nobody made it into the answering service because of the snowstorm. So I was starting to panic, like, what do I do? This is too early. I'm in active labor, my water is broken. There's no going back, there's no stopping this. And took a minute as we were finding towels and trying to find shoes and everything else to get out the door, thought about it. My aunt works at my OB's office. I called my aunt at home. She didn't answer. Call her cell phone numerous times. She finally picks up. She was out snowblowing the driveway. She said, what's wrong? I said, my water broke. Okay, go to the hospital. Get to the hospital. I said, I'm trying. Trying to get out the door. Which hospital am I going to? Because in New Milford, they closed down the birthing center in New Milford Hospital. Mm-hmm. My obstetrician doesn't practice in Danbury. They don't have permissions to practice there. So it was, all right, am I heading north? Am I heading south? Where am I going? Because either way, the hospital is over half an hour away. She in turn called, she told me she'd call me back. She called my doctor at home. And she said, go to Danbury Hospital. One of our friends was at the house at the time. He said, I've got to go shovel. This poor man goes running out of the house. Shoes and just boxers. Like, you need clothes, buddy. It's still snowing, it's freezing, you need clothes. He came back inside, he got dressed, he went running back out. And by this point, Jeff said it's one shot down the driveway. The driveway was steep, there was a cliff on one side. He said it's one shot. Do you want to walk to the bottom of the driveway or do you want to drive? I told him I can't walk to the bottom of the driveway unless you plan on delivering this child at the bottom of the driveway. So he helped me get in the car, he said, buckle up. And we just went, and I remember about 5 minutes of the car ride. Madison had put this round butterfly sticker about this big on the dashboard. That's all I kept staring at, was just the butterfly sticker, like, you're not having this baby in the car, you're not having this baby in the car, you're not having this baby at all, not yet, it's too early. And we made it down to Danbury ER, actually 13 minutes. Should have taken us 30.
Mm.
Don't remember how, all I remember is Jeff looking at me saying, don't yell at me about my driving. And him just going. And he pulled in and blocked the ambulance bay. Left the door open, ran inside, and said, my wife is 25 weeks pregnant, her water broke, she's having the baby. I didn't tell him as we were getting off of the exit on the highway that I already had to push, that I knew there was no time for anything. I didn't want him to start freaking out and panicking. So by the time the security guard made it out with the wheelchair, I said, no, I'm having this baby now. I cannot sit in that chair. Thankfully, my obstetrician had called down there and given them a heads up I was coming. They expected to have time. So they had labor and delivery all prepped to have this premature baby being born upstairs. And one of the PAs from the NICU had come down just to see what was going on. And she saw me and she said, do we have time to make it upstairs? And I just shook my head, no. And I told her, I said, I don't care where we go, just get me out of this car. She kind of got me into a wheelchair. I was standing on the foot pedals and propping myself up on the handles. She got me as far as the triage room. And I told her, we can't go any further. And it was all pretty surreal at that point, because I knew that he was delivering himself. There was nothing I could do about it. So we get in, and I'm in a glass room. It's all windows. I can see the waiting room on all sides of me. I can see all the ER rooms on the other side of me. And you know, there's no privacy, but at that point I didn't care. So the ER doctors come in, he said, let's see how far you are. And I'm undressing myself saying, we don't have time for this. And the next words I hear literally were, oh shit, we have a foot. And Jeff wasn't in the hospital yet because security was yelling at him to park the car.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm telling them, no. My husband's not here yet. No, I'm not doing this without him. And the doctor said, we don't have time for this. I'm gonna try to turn the baby. And I sat up and I looked at him and said, you're gonna do what? He said, I have to turn him around. He's coming out feet first. So he attempted, and there were this tiny little triage room, half the size of the living room here. 40 people in and out, nurses holding up curtains in front of all the glass, and all these NICU doctors and nurses coming down in seeing what's going on. Labor and delivery staff coming in trying to figure out what to do. And he said, well, I can't get him turned around because I was just too far progressed. By that point, he was basically already out to his knees. And Jeff, the security guard, actually threw him into the room because he just went charging in. And the next thing I know, Jeff is being tossed into this room and trying to climb in the bed behind me because I was starting to hyperventilate, freak out. I think you guys need to fix this. This isn't supposed to be happening. This isn't real. And I'm looking at this ER doctor panicking, because what I didn't know at the time is his wife was 25 weeks pregnant. So he's looking at me, delivering Phoenix, thinking about his own son and his own wife. So he's trying to do everything he can. Meanwhile, there's just so many people in there, I didn't know where to focus. I didn't know what to do. And they didn't even look at me and say, okay, it's time to push. It's just my body was doing it naturally because it'd been so long, he was so tiny. so he said, okay, we're delivering him. And they ended up delivering him, and he came out butt first. Because at that point, they just managed to tuck his legs up. So he came out butt first, and the NICU doctor, Dr. Hansen, had just made it into the room as he was being delivered. So just as he came out, she was able to grab him. And there was like the longest 9 minutes of my life. And I kept saying, I'm not going to breathe until he does. And I've got nurses putting oxygen masks on me, another nurse putting IVs in my arm, Jeff behind me telling me to breathe. And they're all trying to ask questions. I couldn't answer anything. I couldn't focus on anything because they weren't prepared in the ER. So they were resuscitating him right between my legs on my gurney. So he's right here. There's nothing I could do. And at that point, I didn't realize that they were still paying attention to me because my focus is on him. You know, everybody should be working for him, not me. And once they got him to breathe, to take his first breath, and once they got his heart going, that's when things started to register to me, and I had started hemorrhaging. So they're taking me one direction up to labor and delivery because I was starting to lose consciousness, and taking Phoenix the other direction to a different floor to the NICU. So they're bringing us both out different directions, and Jeff's standing in the hall. Where do I go? What do I do? And I just looked at him, and the last thing I remember saying was, go with the baby. And I guess I lost consciousness at that point. For the next 2 hours, I had no idea what was going on. They took care of me, and I guess in part of this, when they were trying to wheel me out, I was fighting with them because I had my cell phone in my hand. And the nurses were trying to take it, and I wouldn't let them take my phone. They were trying to take my sneakers off, because I still had sneakers on. I still had pants and underwear and sneakers. And they were trying to do that. I was fighting with them because I just wanted to be with Phoenix. And the nurses told me that their only saving grace was that I lost consciousness so I could stop fighting them. And you know, I'd heard stories of mothers or fathers, you know, parents having that adrenaline rush when it comes to their child and you know, being able to do crazy things. You only believe it to a certain extent until you're in that situation. And it, you know, it really hit home. And I guess Jeff had been texting me pictures and updates, but I wasn't getting them all. And out of my family, my aunt was the first one to make it to the hospital. And they let her in after they were able to control the bleeding and take care of me and give me conscious again. They let her in. And it was still too surreal. Like, this didn't just happen. Why am I in a hospital? What's going on? You know, of course I'm still pregnant. I didn't give birth. And my aunt just looked at me, and then my parents got there. And the look on my stepfather's face is what really drove everything home to me, because he's typically a very happy-go-lucky, always smiling. He doesn't get that somber expression. And he came in, tears in his eyes, and just gave me a hug. And that's when I felt all the emotion. It was just everything hit me in that 1 second, because the one man who's always the light of the room was crying. And I still hadn't seen Jeff yet because they were still working on Phoenix, so he was still in the NICU. Other side of the hospital, one floor down. And once that happened, I kept asking the nurses, can I go downstairs? Can I go see my son? I need to know what's going on. Can you find out what's going on? And I kept getting no's. No, you need to stay here. You need to worry about yourself. No, we can't call down to the NICU. you need to worry about yourself right now. You can't worry about your son. And to me, it felt kind of ridiculous. This is part of me, and if you want me to worry about me, I have to know what's going on with him. I can't calm down. I need to know. And the same PA that came out into the parking lot and got me into the triage room, she was looking around wondering, where's mom? Where's mom? And Jeff said, I don't know. I can't get up there. I don't know what's going on. She doesn't know anything right now. She's not responding to my text messages. He didn't know that I had the issues I was having. Nobody told him anything. So she said, I'm going to get answers. Marched right upstairs, found out what was going on with me. She called the NICU to tell Jeff. She said, do you want to see your baby? I said, yes. And labor and delivery started fighting with her, saying, no, you can't take her anywhere. She can't go anywhere. And she looked at him. She said, tough shit. Grabbed a wheelchair, moved my IVs, everything, helped me get in the chair, and brought me downstairs. But then again, it was like this whole crash when they wheel me into his room and I see this tiny, frail human being attached to more tubes and machines than I ever thought were necessary. And seeing my husband looking so broken. He was just standing there, just tears going, and he's not the overly emotional type. And typically, you know, he's that strong, I've got everything, it's fine, nobody's gonna see me break, nobody's gonna see me bend. And just seeing him so broken. And I asked if I could touch him. I said, I need to touch my son. Can I touch my son? And they told me, no, you can't. He's too frail. His skin is too too thin. His nerve endings were too close to the top of his skin. She said, what would be comforting to a normal newborn will be agonizing to him. And it just tore me up. You deliver, you get pregnant, you expect to have a normal pregnancy. You know, he was my first child. So it's like, okay, you expect this normal labor process. I mean, labor's different every child for every person, but you expect when that baby is born to be able to count fingers and toes and be able to look at your child's face and instantly hold them. And there wasn't any of that. And then I was just being whisked right back out of there because they needed to work on him again and they needed me to go up and rest, and they were talking about the fact that I might need a blood transfusion. And so I just kept telling Jeff, you need to stay here. Just stay here. I want to know everything. I need to know everything. So thankfully, he did. He stayed down and just kept text messaging me updates. And that PA, Jackie, I looked down at my phone and I said, I have 8% battery. Don't know where a charger is. She scoured the hospital and found me a charger for my phone. I said, you need to know what's going on because I don't think anybody's going to tell you otherwise. Found a charger, ran it back up to my room, plugged it in and said, here you go. Here's a direct number to the NICU. And my family had left at that point, and everybody had, they had to go take care of the other kids, and they all had stuff to do. So sitting by myself in the room, and it, that third wave, like, this is real, and there's nothing I can do, and I felt like I failed my child. I mean, my job was to protect him, nurture him, and give him everything he needed for 9 months, and I only did that for 6. So it was really tough. Phoenix was born at 10:33 in the morning. Jeff didn't make it up to my room in labor and delivery until almost 10:30 at night. So for all that time, I was pretty much by myself trying to figure out how to deal with it. And because the short period of time in the NICU, when I got to see Phoenix and everything else, very quiet. You've got to be as quiet as possible in the rooms because they're trying to imitate the womb as much as possible. So he's in this isolette that's covered in blankets. The machines are all super quiet. So there wasn't that time to process, to be able to sit with my husband and say, well, what just happened? And it was really tough. It's hard to look back, say, what was labor like? Because it really wasn't like I had a long labor. It just, everything happened so quick. There was no time to think, just time to react.
When did you begin to process what happened, and what did that look like and feel like for you?
Really fully processed was the day they discharged me from the hospital. Because they discharged me, but he had to stay. And it's not the way the natural order is, you know? When you leave the hospital, you're supposed to be leaving with your newborn baby. You're not supposed to leave your baby in the hospital attached to tubes and monitors and under lights, and he was on a ventilator. That was the worst part. And I don't think I stopped crying for 3 days. Just nonstop crying. It was hard because I had to balance taking care of the other kids and fitting in trips to the hospital and trying to process and deal with my emotions. It was even harder because then everybody's trying to find out what's going on, what's going on, what's going on. So I felt like every 5 minutes I was reliving everything. Mm-hmm. So I tried to shut myself down.
I'm gonna pause here.
Yeah, I guess we'll try through later. I'm really sorry.
In such a vulnerable, I mean, he was so frail and so tiny, and it was not a good time for Jeff and I.
Mm.
Like, that was a really horrible time in both of our personal lives.
Mm-hmm.
But it was really hard.
Mm.
But after I read it like 3 or 4 times, I kept going back through it.
Like,
you know, after I read it 3 or 4 times, it made me sit back and really think about it.
Mm.
So
it sounded like what ended up happening when you reached out to me was that it sort of brought about some healing, you know, by revisiting some of those emotions and that experience.
It did, and I've been able to talk about it without having a breakdown, without resulting in crying and you know, saying, okay, enough, I can't do this. It's been able to open that door for me. Because for a long time I wouldn't talk about it at all, even to family. My mother would ask, how you doing? How's all this? Good, fine, we're done. Nothing. And certain close friends and certain family members, they did know what was going on. And some of the Facebook crowd, like the Facebook following that Phoenix had gotten, they were more generic updates versus, here's how I'm feeling. But thankfully, we did the Facebook page because I couldn't handle the 100 text messages and phone calls and emails that were coming to my phone, let alone the separate 100 that were going to Jeff's. It was just too much.
It's tiring.
And I looked at him one night and said, I can't do this. We can't do this. We need one place for everybody to get their information. Done.
All right. What a smart move.
Yeah, it was a godsend.
Mm.
It really was. It was just once a day, throw something up there.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it. Here you go, people. Don't call me. Don't text me. There you go.
Are you ready?
I'm all set. We have a roll.
Okay. So we'll pick up where we left off. I think I was asking you about when you began to process the experience and what that looked like and what it felt like. And you had shared a little bit about, you know, like leaving the hospital and having him hooked up to the wires and to the ventilator and everything, and going back home to your children that were already there. Maybe the beginning stages of sort of processing what happened.
Yeah, that was the beginning of it. It was when the nurse handed me my discharge paperwork, it started to hit me. When I walked out the door and got in the car in the parking lot and turned around, there was no car seat in the car. It was like, everything's wrong, all of this is wrong, I can't leave. And Jeff had said to me, well, we have to go and take care of the kids right now. We have to take care of the other kids. We'll come back later. And it was basically from that point on, just 3 days crying, not eating, just not talking to anybody, just shut down. And it was even harder when I walk in the house and all the kids are asking where their baby brother is. And Jeff's daughter, Madison, used to turn around every morning and give my belly kisses and give me a hug and say hi to Phoenix and tell me, take care of my brother. So that night, I was braiding her hair before bed. She would do the same thing at night. She would say goodnight and give my belly kisses and say goodnight and tell me, take care of my brother. And I was braiding her hair in the bathroom. She turned around to do the routine and just started crying and said, where is my brother? And it was just like a knife in the heart. Because here's this little girl who doesn't understand at all. You know, 6 years old, she had no concept of the fact that he was born too early and what went on with that. She was expecting when mom came home, her brother came home. And it just put me in this zone where I needed to put up walls. I needed to block all that stuff out and just focus on, I can't let anything get to me. I have to manage everything in my life. Otherwise, I'm gonna be no good for anybody and no good for myself. So that kind of shut me off emotionally.
So it sounds like you went into survival mode. Just sort of, you know, plow through this, put the emotions to the side for now, and just function.
Yeah, that's exactly what it was. There was having all the other kids at home, there was no option for anything else.
Mm.
So from that point on, it was wake up in the morning, get the other kids ready for school, get them off to school, drive to the hospital, find out what was going on with Phoenix, spend time with him, leave there, get the kids home from school, homework, dinner, ready for bed, back to the hospital, 2-3 o'clock in the morning, back home to get a couple hours of sleep, same thing. It was just this endless circle, the routine. And I knew that if I let my emotions drive, then I would never have made it anywhere.
At what point did the emotions take the front seat and take the wheel?
A couple times they came in. Every morning when I woke up, the first thing I would do was call down to the NICU. How is Phoenix doing? What's going on? And the nurses were fantastic. They were like the second family to me. They would fill me in. And about 3 weeks in, they had taken him off the ventilator. They said, he's breathing room air, he's breathing over the ventilator, he's doing great. Took him off the ventilator. He had a couple days, he was doing really well. And when I called, they said, we're about to put him back on the ventilator. And at that point, it was all emotion. Do what you have to do, but I will be there as soon as I possibly can be. And a friend of mine actually took the kids to school so that I could race down to the hospital. And I got there as they were putting him on the ventilator. And that was just pure emotion driven. There was nothing else that mattered right now. He wasn't breathing right. I needed to get down there. But a week after that, he went into renal failure. And I was sitting with my mother in the parent room. And this whole time I was pumping for him to store the milk so that when he could start eating, they could give him breast milk instead of formula. So I was sitting in that room pumping, and the doctor came in. He said, "All right, we've got to sit down and have a serious talk." So I asked him to give me 5 minutes just to finish what I was doing. He did. He came back in. He said, "All right, here's the situation. Your son is very sick, and we're not having any luck." I looked at him. I said, "What do you mean?" He's doing rather well right now, I thought. He's gaining weight. His bilirubin levels have come down. He's getting ready to go back on to the CPAP. He said, "Well, he's in renal failure, and we've tried LASIX, we've tried everything else, and it's not working. We can't get his levels to a safe point. We're giving him a couple more hours, and if that doesn't work, we're going to transfer him to Yale New Haven for peritoneal dialysis, or he will die." And I didn't know what to say, what to do, how to feel. I was kind of like instantly numb. And I didn't have a reaction to him, to the doctor. I think it was just shock. And he walked out of the room, and my mother looked at me and gave me a hug. And my mother is not an affectionate woman. And I was done from there. And I then had to make the phone call to Jeff and tell him what was going on. I said, "You need to leave work." And he was working about 45 minutes away. So he had to drive the truck, park the truck at the lot, and then get his car and drive down to the hospital. So it took him about 2 hours. And the doctors kept coming in saying, "He's getting worse. He's getting worse. Have you had your son baptized yet?" And that's when it started to hit me. Why are you asking me about baptism? He's going to be fine. And it just, my whole world crumbled. And they brought, I can't remember what they call them, but she's one of the priests. She walks around the hospital asking people, "Do you want to pray? Do you want to I'm here if you need me." And she happened to have stopped in the room at that point. The doctors walked out and she came in. So I asked her, "Yes, can you come and say a prayer for my son? Can you come sit with us?" And Jeff stepped out to call his mom. She was down in Florida. We said a prayer and then she left. And the doctor said, "What do you want to do?" And I looked at them like, "What do you mean, what do I want to do?" "Anything. Do whatever you need to do. Save him." The doctor said, "I'm not sure if we can." And Jeff came back in and I just had nothing. I couldn't say anything. I felt like I couldn't breathe. And the doctor turned to Jeff and said, "Well, what do you want us to do?" He said, "Talk to my wife." He said, "I'm trying to, but she's not speaking." And it went like that for like the rest of the day. I just couldn't speak. I couldn't do anything. I pulled the chair up right next to his isolette and I just sat there staring at it. I would stand up to stretch my legs and I don't remember falling asleep like that, but Jeff took a picture where I had my arms like this over the isolette and my head down, looking through the top of it. And I guess I fell asleep because I just drained myself completely. And we were ready for transport. And in the parent room there, they had a couch. I was sitting on the couch and Jeff came in and I just laid right down his lap and cried myself to sleep. They came in and said, "We're getting ready to transport. The transport team will be here in 15 minutes. Do you have a plan?" And it dawned on me, no, we don't have a plan. We don't know what's going on. And the one nurse, her name was Carolyn, she was, her and another nurse named Karen, they were my two saviors. She said, "Okay, let's sit down and talk. We've got some other tests being run right now. We've got to check his levels and write everything down accurately as he's walking out the door. Here are your options." And she laid everything out on the table. And I just stared at her and she said, do you hear what I'm saying?" And I looked at her again. I said, "No, I don't. I don't hear what you're saying." And the other nurse, Karen, came back in and she said, "We're just waiting for the doctor to come in. He'll be right in." And I'm just sitting on the edge of my chair. Jeff is pacing the room. The doctor comes in and said, "We have sent the transport team back. Phoenix doesn't need to go anywhere." And it was just like everything was okay. The world was okay again. I could breathe, I could speak, I could understand what everybody was saying. Because the whole time I'm thinking, they basically told me that I'm losing my son tonight. I have to say goodbye to my son. He hasn't had a chance to see the world. He hasn't had a chance to smile and open his eyes. They still had his eyes taped shut at that point. He doesn't know what mommy's touch is. He doesn't know what daddy's touch is. He hadn't met any of his siblings because they weren't allowed in the hospital yet. And that's all I kept thinking, like, this is my fault that he's not gonna have this. And I kept saying that over and over again, this is my fault, this is my fault, this is my fault. And it took about a year for me to actually process that it wasn't my fault. You know, nothing anybody said to me could change my mind. I failed him, that's all I kept saying. And that was probably, other than the day we brought him home from the hospital, was probably when the emotions were just at their high peak.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, I wouldn't let him get there.
How did you start to cope with the emotions when they did become more present?
I have this very bad habit of being able to shut down. I can shut things off, it's just like a light switch. So that's what I did. It wasn't until, I really didn't start coping with all of it until I read Jeff's interview with you. I just pushed through every day, and once Phoenix was doing better, I was just thankful. He's doing better, he's great. Just astonished every day at what he was doing. I didn't really deal with all of that beforehand.
Did you know that you hadn't dealt with it, or did you think, well, we're in the clear, and sort of swept that under the rug, and we don't have to revisit it, it's not necessary?
That's basically it. It was just like, okay, well, it's done, it's over with. I don't have to process, what is there to process? There's nothing. Mm-hmm. He's fine. I didn't realize that there was so much that went on with that. And there were people in our lives at the time who were saying, "We're here for you, we're here for you, we're here for you." But you really weren't. It was more of the position of, I'm doing a good thing to make myself look good.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really care about what they're dealing with. I want to say I'm helping because I get the gold star. And one of those particular individuals made it more about themselves. So anytime I would feel like it was okay to talk, I was being told, no, you can't. Just move forward. Don't worry about it. You need to be strong. You need to be strong for your kids. You need to be strong for your husband. So that was really just on top of me flipping that switch. That was the, okay, I need to be strong. I can't go there. I can't think about this.
What does that feel like to wear that heavy armor where everything is bottled up, locked up, and you're told there's no space for you to fall apart. There's no room for you to cry. And there's no room for you to feel these emotions.
Now, looking back, I know that I felt claustrophobic. At the time, I didn't understand what I was feeling. I thought, okay, this is, you know, she's telling me this, this is how I have to feel. Mm-hmm. This is what I have to do. Maybe I'm being irrational. But now I look back at it and it was claustrophobic, it was confining. I wasn't able to be who I am, express how I feel, and be able to cope and deal in my own manner.
Did you find that by shutting yourself off to those painful emotions that you were also maybe subduing the joy and the happiness also by trying to keep everything so contained?
Probably. 'Cause there was a lot that I could have found joy in, but because I was just so focused on getting through the day, There wasn't a lot of laughter, there wasn't a lot of smiling, there wasn't, I lost that playful piece of me. And I like to laugh, I like to joke around, love to smile, but for a long time, I just wasn't there. And the kids were always saying, "Mommy, you're being so mean." No, I'm not. I'm not yelling at you, I'm not, but "Mommy, why aren't you doing this? Mommy, why aren't you doing that?" And so yeah, it was tough. And because I had flipped that switch, I had also shut my husband out. And you know, that came back to haunt me later, but I felt like I was doing what needed to be done. I look at it now and I should have done things way different, but hindsight's 20/20.
Well, you're here now and you're talking to me about this and you reached out to share this. And you mentioned that you had come across Jeff's interview that he had done about this same subject matter. Tell me about what that brought about for you, reading that, not even knowing that he had shared that story, how that impacted you.
Initially I was upset, I was angry. To me it was, how dare he do this? I didn't know how he was feeling. Why is he sharing, no offense, but why is he sharing this with strangers when he couldn't share this stuff with me? Why did you do this without consulting me? That's our child. But then after rereading it and after thinking about it and talking to people about it, I realized, well, this was his way to cope with it. This was him talking to somebody who would listen, because I didn't for a while. And it made me sit back and think that, you know what? He was having these emotions. Okay, yeah, he was thinking this. What was I thinking? What emotions was I having? And it really opened my eyes and opened doors for me to look back and say, okay, this is what I was suppressing. This is what I was feeling, but didn't say anything to anybody because I had to put on the facade that I was strong. And so it was definitely therapeutic. Once I got past the anger, it was good.
How have you been processing the experience itself? And I'm sure you continually have challenges with Phoenix's health. you know, due to the way that he came into this world at such a early stage in your pregnancy. How do you have support? How are you coping with those challenges?
I do have support. I've got a great family support system, and Jeff and I support each other with Phoenix very well. And his medical team is amazing. He still does face a lot of medical challenges. He's got his immune system. He still has issues with his eyes, so every 6 months he has to go in and get his eyes checked out. Prolonged oxygen can cause, it's called ROP, retinopathy of prematurity, where it separates the retina in the eye, and it can cause astigmatism and partial blindness, so we constantly have to monitor that. He's got cerebral palsy, so what looks to other people as just a clumsy toddler, it's actually muscle spasms and weakness that's making him fall over. He does have a sensory disorder, so thankfully now we've got a great team in his Excel program through school that works with him, and Birth to Three came out and worked with him twice a week to try to get him caught up to where he should be age appropriately. And physical therapy, I mean, they're amazing. His pulmonologist, she's on my speed dial. The pediatrician and I are, you know, complete first name basis. Here's my home number. If you have any questions, call me at home. I mean, absolutely amazing. So I still try not to focus too much on the what ifs and focus more on the look what he's overcome, because I don't want to constantly overshadow all of his positive progress with all the negative stuff that we went through. And he's just amazing. He's absolutely amazing. He's my inspiration every day.
That was going to be my next question. How has that experience changed your life? What have you taken away from that? What sort of gifts has this brought you?
There's been a couple different things. I mean, I've learned that I can't shut myself off, and that nobody else has a right to tell me how to feel and how to handle my feelings. And I look at Phoenix every morning and think, you've come so far in your 3 little years. Nothing that I have to face today is going to be compared to that. You know, absolutely nothing. He's just my daily reminder. And his whole struggle also helped restore my faith in humanity, because I was pretty cynical before that. And just the outpouring from the community and people that I had never even met, just, you know, prayer lists at churches that I'd never attended. Absolutely amazing. And to see all that and to see that there's still good in the world is amazing. And there are tough days, and I have to reflect, like, okay, it's been worse. It has been worse. Look where you've come.
Sounds like it's given you a shift in perspective to be able to gauge, you know, what is a small thing, you know, and how much attention should we give that, you know. It also sounds like it's given you a deeper sense of gratitude and being able to appreciate the blessings, you know, that you have in your life. The fact that he's three and he's still here, and you know, you could have lost him in those first few hours even.
Yeah. I mean, I do look at things and say, that's just a bump in the road. I've climbed mountains. And it does put things in perspective. And just realizing that a stranger can open their heart to somebody is beautiful. I mean, I was accepting hugs from people I'd never even met and wanting them. You know, nurses coming in, I didn't know their names, and just coming in and giving me a hug and saying, Mom, it's okay. there's a group at Danbury Hospital called Tiny Miracles, and they would drop stuff off. They had no idea who the patients were, parents, nothing. They would just drop stuff off. You need a smile. Here, Mom, here's some hair ties. You know, here, Dad, here's some coffee. Here's a blanket for the baby. Oh, you have other kids? Here's stuff to bring your other kids. Sometimes they would just drop off a book or a quick note thinking of you. You know, there was one day I walked in the room and there was just a smiley face sticker on a piece of paper, and on the back it had the Tiny Miracle sticker. I was like, wow. I never realized a yellow smiley face sticker could turn my day. It, just simple things, simple random acts of kindness like that, just amazing. And I never realized that it could be.
I think we're sometimes surprised, or we don't recognize how important our presence and our gestures of kindness can be in someone else's life, and the impact that those gestures can have. You know, like like Jeff sharing with me, for example, his story. That was, you know, sort of a way for him to move through a healing process. And you're here today, sharing the story as well. And which brings me to another question for you. Were you able to find support with other parents who had gone through similar experiences? Did you find that to be something that was helpful?
Yes and no. There were some of the individuals that were telling me to suck it up, be strong, were parents of preemies.
Mm.
So that's kind of why I was really listening to them. Oh, you've been through this. You know what you're talking about. So in one sense, at the time I didn't realize that it wasn't helpful, that it wasn't what I needed. But I did meet this one. Our son was 3 days earlier in gestation than Phoenix. And we met in the family waiting area because there was no food or anything like that allowed in the room. So everybody would go to eat their meals in this one area. She was out there eating and I came in to eat lunch, and we sat and we talked, and she'd only been there for 2 days. She said, how long have you been here? It was a couple months at that point. And I think it was March, so we'd already been there 3 months. And she just kept asking me questions, and did this happen, and did this happen, and do you know about this, and can you tell me anything? And I had been through with Phoenix a lot of the same things. So it was like, yeah, you know, but here's the upside. Phoenix has pulled through. And I still talk to her every now and again on Facebook. We still connect and check up because her son is doing great now. They're only a couple months apart, so they've met a few times, and it's nice. She just lives like four towns away, so it gets hard to do get-togethers.
Mm.
But other than that, there's not too many people that I've really been able to talk to.
Has it inspired you in any way to be that person for someone else? I mean, I suppose you are in a way right now just by sharing the story.
Yeah, I mean, I ran across the one person who had a preemie daughter, not to the extent of Phoenix. But, you know, so I started to take her under my wing and, you know, help her out. But it turned out to be bittersweet because she didn't really care. It was like the, oh, you're going to help me out? What are you going to give me?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of the understanding and appreciating the moral support, it was, what are you going to do for me? So it was pretty bittersweet. And in the end, finding out that she really didn't care what was going on with her daughter bothered me, and that she was just milking it for attention.
Mm-hmm.
Really bothered me. So for a while, that shut me off.
Mm-hmm.
To trying. It was like, all right, I don't want to get dragged down that rabbit hole again.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to focus on on my family.
If you were to offer someone who's either watching this interview or reading it, what advice would you offer to them if they can relate to your experience? Whether it's, you know, closing yourself off to some sort of trauma, you know, shutting yourself off emotionally and the impact that that has, or going through these challenges with a premature birth and some of the issues that you face.
As far as the premature birth part of it, never get online. Don't read anything online. It's the worst thing you can do. Because then all day long, every little beep, every little whistle, noise, everything is just, what's going on? Oh my God, it's terminal now. So just rely on the nurses. They'll walk you through everything. Rely on the doctors. NICU staff is extremely supportive. And they'll be a second family to you and to your child. And don't shut yourself off. It's taken me almost 3 years to deal with everything and to process everything in full and to be able to talk about it without turning into a grizzly bear. You know, process it. Deal with it however you feel you need to. Don't let anybody else dictate it to you.
What has been the most helpful for you in dealing with it and sort of balancing all these plates that you have spinning?
I think it's more of a personal thing for me. I can look at Phoenix and see everything that he's overcome and everything that he's went through and how happy he is today. And for the most part, healthy. So that gives me some sort of solace to be able to look back and reflect on it.
How much of a role does faith or hope play in all of this?
I pray every day. Every single day. And a lot of it is giving thanks. You know, thank you for helping. Thank you for showing him the right direction to go. Thank you for being our support. So a lot of it is giving thanks. But I never give up hope. I am not, and never have been, the type to say, well, this is pointless.
Mm.
It's like, I'm an optimist till the end. The glass is always half full. And if it tips over, it's refillable.
Mm.
That's the way I look at it.
Is there a favorite quote that you'd like to share?
In relation to Phoenix?
Anything that comes to mind.
Well, because we're discussing Phoenix and his ordeal, it would be the quote walking through the NICU. Right on the NICU wall before you get to the doors to get buzzed in, it says, a person is a person no matter how small.
And what does that mean to you?
Well, it's a Dr. Seuss quote from Horton Hears a Who. But to me, it's, never lose sight. You know, Phoenix was this frail little thing in an isolette. I couldn't hold for 4 weeks. And when I could first hold him, 5 minutes at a time. And it kind of makes you lose sight that he's going through a lot as well. And regardless of his state, and you know, when they would come in and say, your baby is sick. My baby has a name. His name is Phoenix. Please use his name. He had emotions. He had feelings. He deserved everything, just like everybody else did. So that's what it means to me. It doesn't matter how small he was.
How did you choose the name Phoenix?
About 2 weeks before I had him, we had just found out he was a boy. We're still playing with names. And we had tossed a few names around for boy names. About a week before I had him, we had gotten some snow, or snowed in the house, We were doing a movie marathon. We had no cable. The cable went out, so we were DVD marathoning. And we chose Indiana Jones, watch from beginning to end. This will keep everybody occupied. Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade came on, and the opening credits, young Indiana, played by River Phoenix. And I'm reading the credit. I was like, oh, that's a pretty cool name. Jeff looked at me and said, what, River? I said, no, Phoenix. He sat back. He didn't say anything else. For a couple days, they kept throwing it at him. Really like the name Phoenix. It's great, boy or girl. Really like the name Phoenix. He's like, oh, I don't know. And he called me up on work one day. He's like, I have a compromise for you. I'll let you have the name Phoenix if you let me have the middle name Jacob. The funny part about it was we had already agreed on the middle name Jacob, no matter what the first name was. And so that was it. It was just saw a name in a movie credit and loved it. And who knew that all this was going to happen and he was going to live up to his name?
Mm-hmm.
When they were reviving him, one of the nurses asked, because they kept saying, come on, little boy. Come on, baby boy. Let's breathe. I said, do you guys have a name yet? I couldn't speak at all. And Jeff had answered and said his name is Phoenix. And I remember everybody's head whipping around. What? Sorry? And one of the nurses said, did you just pick that out? And both of us shook our head. No, we already had his name picked out. You know, who knew that his name was going to have such meaning for him? He did. He rose up from everything. He's overcome. He's overcome every obstacle. And people keep saying, oh, what are you going to give him for a nickname? Phoenix. You don't need to give him a nickname.
Mm.
He's a birdie.
How has it felt to talk about these feelings and this experience with you today?
It's nice to be able to talk about it very openly and have somebody ask questions. It's nice to be able to talk about it without crying, without feeling like I can't. It's liberating. It's part, I guess it's part of the end of my healing process for it.
Do you think that it's possible that by sharing your experiences and your own emotional experiences, that you could be bringing someone else some hope, or some inspiration, letting them know that they're not alone in whatever challenges they're facing?
Sure. I mean, people can find hope and inspiration in the craziest things. I used to carry around a little worry stone that said hope on it. And I'd rub it all the time and it would just be calming and soothing to me. It was a rock. So this could definitely help somebody else in ways that I couldn't even imagine.
Thank you.
No, thank you.
That's it.